How is everybody? Good? Thumbs up? Marshall, how about that? That was cool. That was fun. I don't need to say much else. I think that was exciting. I had not been that engaged in a while. So I'm lucky to be alive. I had some heart palpitations yesterday. Might still be feeling a few, but that's fine. We exist, Mercy Village Church, we exist to experience and embody redemption and renewal in Christ alone. These two frames up here, one to your right, one to your left, one is our mission, one is our... The mission is our goals, our desires, what we kind of like, why do we exist? What are we here for? And then this is a picture of what that looks like from 30,000 feet vision. Our mission is that we exist to both experience for ourselves. We have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, every single one of us, and also embody to one another, to live it out to one another, the redemption and the renewal that is ours in Christ. That's what we're here for. And Lord willing, that'll be your experience here as well. A few announcements. This coming Saturday, we'll have our second installment, but they're not like on a continuum. You can drop in the Forge Men's get together any Saturday morning. Like you're not. It's not like you've missed a piece of it and you didn't come to the first one. So that'll be this Saturday morning, the 17th, 7 a.m. So be here for that. If you feel like getting up early and hanging, we're just going to read the Bible. We're going to pray. We're going to talk about how that applies to our lives as men. We had our first workshop yesterday, where it's like a parenting workshop, It was great. We'll do it again this coming Sunday, a week from today. I think it's from 4 to 6. Yes, so from 4 to 6. Plenty of books left for that. So if you are wanting to participate in that and haven't signed up yet, feel free. You can sign up online. We should have plenty of spots available. The reason we were having RSVPs is so we can make sure we have enough books. And I think we still have maybe 16 of those books. So we should be able to handle if anybody else wants to sign up for that. Membership class, I mean, we're busy, aren't we? A week from tomorrow, we're busy, I'm busy, I got to do all this. Good. What's wrong with me? I don't know if I had a calendar in front of me when I decided to do one weekend. We'll do it all in one weekend. Monday from 5:30 to 8 on September the 19th, we're going to do our membership class instead of three installments, one evening. So you can sign up for that in the lobby, or we'll post today an online sign-up place as well. We'll do it again in October, three Sunday mornings in a row if you can't make one. So just because you take the class doesn't mean you have to be a member of the church. It's not like a catch-22. If you just want to learn about Mercy Village Church, what we believe, why we believe it, how we're living that out, it's a great opportunity for that. And then Fall Fest Parade is the 22nd of this month. If any of y'all, you kids or young at heart, mainly just the kids, want to ride in the parade, let Faith Early know ASAP. She wants to get on the same page, get those names written down. We're going to try to have kids-sized T-shirts. I don't know if we're going to have them in time. But if we don't, you can just wear an adult-sized T-shirt, right? It can be like a dress. You guys will look cute in a nice baggy T-shirt. You can cinch it up around the waist, don't you think? Yeah, it'll be nice. But if any of your kiddos want to ride on the float in the Fall Fest Parade, let Faith Early know. That is our announcements for this morning. We're going to pray, as we always do. And in that, we're going to invite... Not invite, by the way. I almost, theologically, God is always with us, okay? He doesn't need an invitation. When I say we're going to invite God to do something in our lives, it's not because He's withheld by our unwillingness. You know that just as well as I do. He's sometimes got you in places where you're like, I'm not sure I want to do this for you. And He leads you in that direction anyway. We're going to open our hearts and prepare our hearts to receive what it is that He has for us today. So one of the ways we do that periodically, and we make it as awkward as possible, but you can just kind of look out of the corner of your eye. See if there's anybody you recognize up and down these aisles. And as I pray for us to be open, I want you to pray for the people around you, just in your heart. Even if it's just your family or your spouse or a friend of yours that's just down the row from you, as I pray, you in your hearts, pray for those around you to be prepared to receive what God has for us today. Father, thank you so much that we can gather in your presence as the people of God, a family that is being built from every tribe and tongue and nation. And there's already a ton of diversity in here as far as our life experiences, where we come from, what you're doing in our lives. But yet together, we are the people of God. And we are deeply thankful for that, for this opportunity. Might we not waste it? Prepare our hearts to receive what it is you have for us today. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen. Will you stand with us? If you're new with us, we're going to start our service by singing music together, singing truth to one another. Remind ourselves of the promises that God has made, that He has kept, and that He has made to us in the future. And we do this together as family with our kids. We worship our God and Savior. Let's sing together. Come on, church.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen One. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. Because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Because He lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame, and I heard mercy call my name, and He rolled the stone away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, every fear is gone. And I know He holds my life, my future in His hands. Amen. Amen. because he lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Amen, amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because he lives, because he lives.
Amen. We're gathered here today reminded of what he has done for us, that he sent Jesus to save us, to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. He's given us his righteousness, cleansed us of sin. And so we lift our voices today and we sing together.
And robed in everlasting light, your glory flood the earth and fills the skies. Almighty God, there's no one like you. And mountains tremble when you speak. I'm listening, your whisper changes everything. Almighty God, there's no one like you. Almighty God, there's no one like you. You are the Lord, forever lifted high. You are the Lord, compassionate and kind. You are the Lord, and holy, holy, holy is your name. And holy, holy, holy is your name.
Slow to anger,
slow to anger, rich in love. You're patient, always chasing after us. And this is your heart, there's no one like you. How great you are, there's no one like you. And you are the Lord, forever lifted high. You are the Lord, compassionate and kind. You are the Lord, and holy, holy, holy is your name. And you are the Lord, so let the nations sing. You are the Lord, and Jesus, King of kings. You are the Lord, and holy, holy, holy is your name.
Holy,
and holy, holy, holy is your name.
Come on, church.
And you broke off my heavy chain, left them in the empty grave, and there is freedom in your name. There's no one like you, God. There's none like you.
Sing it again.
And you broke off my heavy chains, left them in the empty grave, and there is freedom in your name. There's no one like you, God. There's none like you.
You are
the Lord, forever lifted high. You are the Lord, compassionate and kind. You are the Lord, and holy, holy, holy is your name, and you are the Lord. Let the nation sing, you are the Lord. And Jesus, King of Kings, you are the Lord. And holy, holy, holy is your name. Sing holy. Holy, holy, holy is your name. You are the Lord.
In Isaiah 55, we read, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. This next song is a prayer today. We don't need more of ourselves or more of this world. We need more of Jesus. Let's sing this together.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. And when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, when I am alone, give me Jesus.
Come on, church.
And give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all give me Jesus. And when I am afraid, oh, when I am afraid, when I am afraid, give me Jesus. And give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus.
Sing this next part knowing that Jesus has defeated sin and death. He has conquered death.
And when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, And when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus.
Sing it again.
And give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. You can have all this world,
you can have
all this world, and you can have all this world, but give me Jesus.
Heavenly Father, thank you today. God, anything good in this life that we enjoy, it's just temporary. It's a small picture into a window of enjoying life with you forever. You have created all of these things that we enjoy. But God, help us to not miss the Creator. If you have created these things and you have given us these things, how much more forever we will spend with you. God, if there's someone lost today that doesn't know you, reveal yourself to them so that they too can partake not just in these things of this world in the temporary, but forever with you in glory. God, teach us today from your word. Help us to know you more deeply. God, you know us and yet you love us. And we're thankful for that today. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Kids are dismissed.
I'm gonna stay till my heart starts changing. Oh, I'm gonna worship till I mean every word. 'Cause the way I feel and the fear I'm facing doesn't change who you are or what you deserve. I give you my worship. You still deserve it.
Gary back there, he does a lot for us. We got him doing lights and doors and sound and slides and yeah, so he doesn't charge us. No, we love you, Gary. Philippians 1 says, "For I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance, as it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage now, as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. We read this together. The next one? No. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God.
My fault, as with many things around here. Okay. There's no keeping it a secret when you read the scripture before the sermon. We've come to what is probably the first of several in the book of Philippians, more well-known verses. If you were brought up in church or even around the church, you've heard those words before: for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Paul's bold proclamation from Philippians chapter 1. We took our sermon title from this, actually. I don't think we've shown the art for a while, but we called the sermon series Philippians When Loss is Gain, or we could have called it When Death is Gain. And I get that it's maybe sounds radical, what Paul says, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Sounds fairly dramatic, sounds a little over the top, but for the Christian, it isn't. I don't want us to see this as some hoorah statement, right? Like, let's take the hill, you know, hoorah. But more of like just a basic, everyday reality for the children of God. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Paul writes this in the middle of a letter that's filled with joy and affirmation and confidence and hope. This isn't like a psych everybody up letter. He's just stating it very matter-of-factly. To live is Christ, to die is gain. We sang it last week. We sang these lyrics. What is our hope in life, in death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belongs. Quickly becoming one of my favorite songs. But I always pick the ones that nobody else likes. So hopefully, that's just how my music tastes are. But I love this song. This isn't a new idea. This song's new. I think it's less than just a couple years old. But this is straight from the Heidelberg Catechism, 1563. Well, actually, let's look at the New City Catechism first, though, because we say this with our kids. What is our only hope in life and death? That we are not our own, but belong body and soul, both in life and death, to God and to our Savior, Jesus Christ. 1563 Heidelberg Catechism says, what is our only comfort in life and death? That I am not my own, but belong with body and soul, both in life and in death, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ, who has fully paid for all my sins. You go back even further to the 5th century, the end of the Apostles' Creed, which starts, I believe in God the Father, almighty maker of heaven and earth. It ends by saying, I believe in the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting. Amen. You go back to the 3rd century. The Nicene Creed ends very similarly. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The old Roman symbol, which is a 2nd century writing, which is a precursor to the Apostles' Creed, says, I believe in the resurrection of the flesh. So we just went down, right, all the way back through history, and then you get back to the 1st century, and you have the Apostle Paul writing, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. It's a very matter-of-fact, everyday reality for the people of God. It's basic, it's normal, that we would think this way about living and dying. So I want us to get this today. Jesus is more than enough for your everyday and for your dying day. That's the point of the verses we're looking at today. Jesus is more than enough for your everyday and for your dying day. So might we live and die for Jesus alone. And I want to emphasize that, because when we hear a verse, to live is Christ, to die is gain, I tend to gravitate towards death is gain part, right? That's a two-part verse, though. It's the living and the dying, both in Christ, both filled with hope. It's living and dying. Jesus is more than enough for both. So, Father, today what we know not, please teach us. What we are not, please make us. And what we have not, please give us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. He starts, Paul does, in this section with his hope-filled expectation. There's some things that he has an expectation of, two to be exact, that he reveals in these first few verses. He says, yes, and I will rejoice. That's the last half of verse 18, which we finished last week. Verse 19, for I know that through your prayers, saints at Philippi, and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this, he's still talking about his imprisonment, his suffering, this imprisonment and suffering will turn out for my deliverance, as it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. So the main observation from those verses are these expectations that he has. There's a couple other little things we'll touch on too, some other observations. But first he says, I have an expectation of deliverance. That from this suffering, he's in a time of suffering. If you've been with us, we've talked about this almost every week. He's in a Roman prison or a home confinement of some sort, but he is in chains. His freedom is outrageously limited, and not only that, but he certainly has an inkling of this because it's been prophesied over him that he's going to die, and he knows it too, that his death is imminent. He will be, within the next 4 years, beheaded by the Roman Empire. So he's not only in captivity, but he's facing the potential of his own death. But he says this very circumstance will work for my deliverance and my freedom from shame and suffering. Another place that Paul writes about this is in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. He's talking about suffering. He says, more than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering is doing something. We talked about this last week. Suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. Hope in the promises of God. Hope in deliverance. Hope in freedom from shame. And hope does not put us to shame. That's what he says. If you hope in the promises of God, if you hope in the future realities that God has said will be, that hope will not be put to shame in an ultimate sense. That doesn't mean that nobody in your life will ever think you're a fool to follow Jesus with all your heart. But that ultimately you will not be put to shame for that hope. Why? Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. There is a promised deliverance from shame, a promised deliverance from suffering. And notice how Paul frames it. That deliverance comes either in life or in death. Either he will be delivered from it in his living, he will be rescued by God, or he will be called home to God. Either way, deliverance. He doesn't see death as a curse. He sees death as a gateway into deliverance. Either delivered in this life or delivered through his death. The next expectation that he has is that his existence, his body, his life, he says, God will be glorified in my body. He's not just talking about his physical body. He's talking about his whole entire self, all of me, and not just all of me as I write this, but all of me past, present, and future. The entirety of who I am throughout all of my being will be used to glorify God. It will honor Jesus. He says, I expect these two things to be true. That's not ego, right? He's not saying, because my life has been so great. He's the chief of sinners. He self-acknowledges that. He has a thorn in the flesh that he talks about, how there's this weakness that he constantly has throughout his whole ministry. He acknowledges his own weakness. It's not an ego statement, but instead it's a confidence statement in what we saw 2 weeks ago when he said to the Philippian church, he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. His confidence is in the finished work of Jesus on the cross. His confidence is in the promises of God, both for his deliverance and for his life to mean something. So those are his expectations. In living or in dying, my deliverance will come. I'll be freed from shame and suffering. And my life's going to matter. It's going to count for something. He's confident of that. And inset into that hope and outflowing from that expectation is hope and courage. He uses both of those words in there. So even in prison, even facing his death, coursing through the veins of the Apostle Paul is hope and courage. In the face of death, in the face of suffering, hope and courage. That happens concentrically, by the way. What I mean is, as he looks at the promises of God, of his own deliverance and freedom from shame, that fills him with hope and courage. And as he's filled with hope and courage, he believes all the more in the promises of God for his deliverance and his freedom from shame. As he trusts God's promise that his existence, Paul's life, is going to count for the glory of God, right? That inspires him with hope and courage. And as he walks with hope and courage, that leads him to have all the more expectation that his life will count for something. They play off of each other. They work together. That's the main point. A few other observations, and we're going to spend a tiny bit of time here because Paul just tiny bit of time to them. But you know he mentions prayer. He says, pray for me. To the saints. He calls the saints to pray for him. And I think that matters because in his suffering, he says what he wants the Philippian church to do is pray for him. Because it's through that, he says, God will work for my deliverance. Now, that's interesting, right? Because the Bible teaches us a lot of things about God. One of the things the Bible teaches us about God is his sovereignty. In the sense that there's no one higher up the organizational chart than God. Not even close. He's at the top. There's no enemy that can defeat him. There's no one that can stop him. Right? So if I fail to pray, is that going to somehow sabotage God's plan? No. That would be heretical to think that, well, I know how to stop God, I just won't pray. It'd be a real puny God that could be stopped by that. However, and you see this all through Scripture, and it's a gift to the saints. God chooses in his all-powerful, full sovereignty to say, I'm going to work through the prayers of my saints sometimes. That's how I'm going to accomplish what I'm doing. And so Paul says, pray for me, and it's going to work for my deliverance. So prayer matters because God says it matters. Not because God is your butler who only responds when you pray. But God says prayer matters, and therefore prayer matters. And in certain cases in Scripture, and again, this is your mind's not made to understand this. God is all powerful and in absolute control, but he chooses to work through your prayers. So pray, it matters. And he talks about the Holy Spirit, too. He talks about the Spirit of Christ, which I take to mean the Spirit that comes from Christ when he departs, when he goes back to heaven, he ascends. He says, I'm going to leave the Holy Spirit with you. He leaves the Holy Spirit with them. And the takeaway from that is Paul can't do this by himself. Our prayers, the prayers of the saints for Paul aren't enough. God has to be at work in this situation. Apart from that, nothing can happen. Okay. So that is the main takeaway of those first couple verses. An expectation, a hope-filled expectation. Now he makes the truth-filled declaration that we started with. This is the kind of the hinge point of this whole first chapter in a lot of ways. When he says in verse 21, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Hope-filled expectation leads to truth-filled declaration. He says, all these promises are true, and I believe that they are. And I'm filled with hope and courage because of the promises of God and the realities that God has bestowed upon me, then I can make this truth-filled declaration. Living is all about Jesus, and dying is gain. And that's beautiful. In fact, this isn't the first time he's talked about it. You talk about living is Christ. You go back to Galatians, and we were in this book together last year. Galatians 2:20, he says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Now, I'm not preaching these verses today. I'm simply using them to point to this reality that Paul believes that every bit of his life, ever since he came to faith in Jesus, that all of the old man, the old desires, the old will, it died with Christ. And the new man in Christ has been raised up. So he says, now my life is no longer the Apostle Paul's life, but my living is for Jesus. When I wake up in the morning, give me Jesus. All the way when I come to die, give me Jesus. And everything in between, give me Jesus. My living is for Jesus. Not just for Jesus, but by the power of Jesus. I live for Jesus by the power of Jesus. This is a holistic, revolutionary change to the direction of Paul's life, and it should be for us as well. It should take selfishness and slowly crush it. It should take ego and slowly crush it. It should take anger and slowly crush it. Now, you just put whatever in there that's not like Jesus and slowly crush it as we become more and more like Jesus and live for His desires, not our own. And he's covered the death is gain idea, concept too. In 2 Corinthians 5:8, he says this, yes, we are of good courage and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. Right before that, he says, we walk by faith, not by sight. He says, when I leave this body, I'm going straight to be with Jesus. That's why all the your Appalachian grandma who said, I can't wait to be at home with Jesus, her theology was correct. Her doctrine was right. To go home and be with Jesus, to die for the Christian is to go home and be with Jesus. And when you put these two things together in Romans 14, 17, you have what we actually started with. I'm sorry, 7 and 8. Chapter 14, 7 and 8. For none of us lives to himself and none of us dies to himself. For if we live to the Lord, and if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. You being owned, right, by the Lord is your hope. And I know that we're Americans, right? And we like freedom and autonomy. But you know the great theologian Bob Dylan was right when he said, it may be the devil, it may be the Lord, but you're going to have to serve somebody. Full autonomy is not a real thing. You've learned that. You're either going to serve the desires of your heart. And if you are honest, sometimes the desires of your heart lead you down destruction alley. And you just can't stop yourself from it. You're like, this is going to hurt. This is going to ruin me. But man, I mean, just think about what you maybe chose to eat or drink yesterday during the football game. Come on. I mean, like, in all honesty, I'll just talk. Maybe the rest of y'all made great choices yesterday. I don't know. But my point is, you can be a slave to your own desires, to the desires of evil, or you can be a slave to Jesus. That's what Paul's saying. And he's saying that's our comfort, actually, that we belong to God because he's a good king. His ways are best. His ways are perfect. You're going to have to serve somebody. Why not serve the one who makes life Christ and death gain? Serve him. Belong to him. What joy and comfort Paul gleans from that. But not just joy and comfort and hope and courage. He has a dilemma, too, that he presents. This gives him a dilemma, but it's more like Austin's ice cream dilemma. Like when you get to Austin's and you don't know which flavor to choose because there's so many good ones. By the way, and I'll just help you guys out. It is black raspberry ice cream. So don't waste your time with the others. See, I don't have a dilemma when I go to Austin's. It's straight for the black raspberry ice cream. It works every time. No fail. But that, again, now they put chocolate chunks in it, so you might think, well, there's a dilemma there now, right? Do I get the chunks or not the chunks? Well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? Like, you can't, if something's perfect, can you make it better? No. It might still be good, but it's worse than what it is. So that's not in my notes. But anyway, he says, I face a dilemma. If to live is Christ and to die is gain, here's the dilemma he presents. Verse 22. If I am to live in the flesh, he's presenting the two sides. If I'm to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Right? If I keep living, I serve Jesus, I walk with Jesus, I serve the church. Yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Now, one thing you got to understand, he's not, by any stretch of the imagination, thinking he has power over his own living and dying. His dilemma here is not with, well, should I die or live? Because once I make the choice, then I'll follow through with it. No, he's saying, which one should I cling to as my deepest desire in my heart right now? Because they're both good. To live is to love you, Philippian saints. To serve you, to serve the cause of Jesus, and there will be fruit in that. But to die is to be with Jesus. Which will I choose? Option A, keep living for Jesus and his church. There's fruitful labor. There's necessary work on their account. Or B, go home and be with Jesus, which is far better. He doesn't hide very well which one he really wants in his own heart. He wants to go home. I'll never forget, and she's home now, my wife's mom. It was one of the earliest memories and one of the most constant memories I have of her. Is her talking about going home to be with Jesus like she was talking about going to the grocery store. It was that much of a reality to her. That much of a joy to her. I'm not saying she didn't fear death. I'm just saying she knew, I'm going to go home, be with Jesus, her friend. Now she is. Another guy I kept thinking of, I don't even know his name, never met him. We would go camping at Holly River State Park in Webster County, West Virginia, every year when I was a kid. And even as a kid, I remember sitting there. There was this old as dirt guy who would get up there and sing. And he couldn't sing anymore. I bet he used to be able to sing. And he'd sing something like Beulah Land, Sweet Beulah Land, or you know, on that day I'll cross the river and fight life's final war with death, you know, whatever about going home. And that guy, literally, it would be like transcend. Like, I'm like, what is he looking at? I couldn't even, like, he would zone out. I swear he saw heaven. Was that confident, man? That's where Paul's at. He is that confident that death is to go home. And that's what he wants. And he owns that that's what he wants. I've been through enough shipwrecks. I've been through enough stonings. I've dealt with y'all knuckleheads long enough. I just want to go home. I heard his voice on the road to Damascus, and it captured me. I want to see his face. I want to touch his... I want to hold hands with him, right? Tyler Childers sang about that this week. Hold hands with Jesus, not even care that he's not a blue-eyed man. He wants to go home. That's his dilemma. Grammatically, he's yearning in the depths of his soul, just yearning to go home, to be with Jesus. But he's also grammatically torn in two in the Greek. He is ripped apart. Why? Because he loves Jesus and he loves people. Sound familiar? That's the Shema. The prayer from Deuteronomy, you will love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Paul loves his Lord with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength. But then Jesus adds, love your neighbor as you love yourselves. On these two commands hang all the law and the prophets. Paul's living it out. He's like, I'm torn up. I want to go home, but I want to love you guys too. And so he comes to his conclusion, and it's love that leads him there. And these are our last verses. Verse 25, we see his choice. What am I going to give my heart over to? Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy and faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you. He wants to keep living. This is not what he really wants. He wants to go home. But he says, I'm going to give myself to keep on living for Jesus, because in living for Jesus, there will be growth and joy for the church, and there will be glory for Jesus Christ. Those two things. Spoiler alert, in chapter 2, he's going to say these words, do nothing out of selfish ambition. Do nothing out of selfish desires. And here he's living it. And again, I think it sounds crazy unless you've been with somebody like Mama, who is just so certain that what awaits her after death is face to face with Jesus, who can sit there and say, I just want to go home. But that's what Paul wants more. But what he chooses selflessly is to live, to keep on living, to keep on going for the sake of the church and for the glory of Jesus. Might we live that today? Might we be shaped by that, right? Like in our living, might it be for others and for Jesus? Might our living be for others and for Jesus? And might our dying be welcomed gain? Those two massive things. That's Christianity. That's a whole big bunch of what Christianity is. And you're living, Jesus and people. And you're dying, gain. We can't generate that in ourselves. Only God can pull that off in us. And so these applications come under that understanding. This isn't like a get your life together type of thing. This is a run to Jesus with desperate hearts saying, change me, transform me, make me different. Because number one, might we be people who don't waste our living. Don't waste your living. That's the decision Paul arrives at. He spent his whole life not wasting his living. He says, the remaining years of my life, I'm not going to waste them either. I'm not going to waste my living. Start with praying for each other and for yourself to that end. Because it has to be God that does that. He said that at the beginning of the passage. God has to pull this off in me and in you. So pray. When you pray for Mercy Village Church, when you pray for yourself, when you pray for the people you love, pray, God, make us these kinds of people. That in our living, it's for Jesus. And in our dying, it's gain. That we believe these things more tomorrow than we do today. And then continue leveraging your time, your talents, and your treasures for the sake of the body of Christ. Your time, your gifts, what you're good at, and your resources for the good of the church. To live is Christ. Don't waste your living. Don't waste your living. And then second, ask God for a gospel view of death. Might God give us all a gospel view of death. We sang this last week. Unto the grave, what will we sing? Right? Like on your dying day, what will you sing? When you bury the person you love the most, what will you say? Christ, he lives. Christ, he lives. And what reward does the grave bring? Everlasting life with him. And we will rise to meet the Lord, and sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore. That's a biblical view of death. That's gain. You get to eat with Jesus. He's going to serve you. The food at the marriage supper of the Lamb, right? He's going to serve you the meal. That's gain. No more sin. No more pain. That's gain. Might we have a gospel view of death. Matt Boswell, one of the guys who helped compose and write this song, he talks about how his son was going through a season where he was incredibly afraid of death every night in his bedroom, scared to death of dying. So they're writing this song, man. And he's a composer. So he's at home. He's got piano at his house. So he's like playing it on the piano, and like working out the lyrics and working out the tune or whatever you call it. I don't even know. That's why I don't write songs. And as the days go by, he can hear his son singing, "What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone. Christ alone." That's why we sing the songs we sing, by the way. We sing them for Sunday morning to be together, but we hope that they give us gospel truths that we can carry with us through our lives in the face of our fears. Brothers and sisters, death is gain. I'm going to play a clip from R.C. Sproul. You've heard his name before. Listen to his words, and I'll tell you the story about it.
See him nearing death. Listen to his breath. Through the ebbing pain, final whisper, gain.
In 2013, John Piper wrote a poem. John Piper was a pastor, now he's just a theologian, so was obviously. About a person doing all of their living for Christ. The last line of the poem was that, about dying. He had all of these other theologian friends read different parts of the poem. And yet R.C. Sproul read the last part. R.C. Sproul would be dead by 2017. And I've never been able to hear him say those words without just tearing me up inside, because I know that he lived it to the end. Listen to his breath. Right? Final whisper. He died on the ventilator. The ventilator had to help him breathe. Paul didn't even have a head on his shoulders to whisper. But his life, his final whisper was gain. Now, hear me today. Our faith in that reality, maybe it's only a mustard seed for you. Maybe death makes you afraid. Maybe you don't stand here with rock solid, unshaking confidence like Mama had, that when you take your last breath here, your first breath will be a gasp. Jesus. Maybe you'll see it with that level of confidence. I'm telling you, a mustard seed of faith is enough today, because God grows hope from mustard seed's worth of faith. You can sing that song we sang last Sunday with just a squeaky little desperate, help me believe this more, mustard seed worth of faith. That's enough. But no. This is our hope. Another one of the collaborators of the song, and I know I'm talking about this song a lot, we at least have to sing it one more time now before we exit out of the repertoire. Jordan Coughlin, when they started writing this song, his son, who was 12 at the time, who had beaten leukemia at 2.5 years old, came back. He probably died. Father came up to bury his son. Around the house. Hope springs in front of you. That's the lyrics, those final lyrics, those sing hallelujah in the face of death. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, say hallelujah now whenever we confess Christ, our hope and life. Okay. I don't know what to say with an idea so big. I don't know how to quote that. I guess my prayer, my hope, is that just this many people sitting in this room. It's a good crowd for a church plant, but in comparison to the whole world, this isn't a lot of people. But if every person in here said, in my living, Jesus, and in my dying,
yeah.
And every day we believe that a little bit more than the day before. And a little bit more than the day before. And a little bit more the next day. It's trying to world us up. And be those people. Like that mustard seed of faith that some of us have, that death is gain, grow bigger and bigger and bigger. Like that desire inside of us that ebbs and flows, that our living be for the sake of Jesus, might that grow more and more and more with each passing day.
Live as Christ, die as gain, might this be the heartbeat of Mercy Village Church. Jesus is more than enough for your everyday and for your dying day. So you might live and die. For Jesus, might it be that simple. And live and die. You're
not a Christian. Final whisper in death, you'll be lost. The Bible says it's appointed unto every person once to die, and after that, judgment before God. The only way through judgment into gain is through Jesus. Jesus holds out his death on the cross, his burial, and his resurrection to you. He says, believe on my finished work on the cross, and you will be. Not a Christian. Death can begin. Yeah. I'd love to talk to you about what it means to be a Christian. I will be here. I'm driving to Brooklyn. I won't talk to you. I will hope you know my heart. If you're here today wrestling with what it means to be a Christian, I'll give up my whole week's playing to talk to you about what it means to follow Jesus. Nothing would make me happier. Do you want to make me happy? I'm just kidding. But like, seriously. That's a joke. Don't trust Jesus to make me happy. I'm just telling you, I would love that. Father, thank you so much that in you we have a purpose for living. An unshakable, unquenchable purpose for living. And in dying, we have hope of infinite gain. These are truths. They're on paper. They're in our hearts at some level. Increase the level at which they're in our hearts. If anyone here that's not a Christian, I pray that today would be the day that they trust the finished work of Jesus on the cross, and for them death becomes gain. And living becomes peace.
To a time of remembering what Jesus has done for us, his body and his blood shed for us. Be with us. We do this as a weekly reminder. We'll do an altar call here, but we are faced with the reality of what Jesus has done for us personally. And so we take this communion together. Today we're going to hand it out on each side as the song plays. Then we'll come back together and we'll take communion together as family. But before we do, I want to read in 1 Corinthians 11, Apostle Paul says, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And in the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' As often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning this body eats and drinks judgment in himself." And so we're going to take this today as family. Before we do, if you need to confess any sin that may be in your heart, do that in the quiet of the moment. But we must take this as a celebration of what Jesus has done. If you're not a believer, just observe, but trust Jesus.
Okay, receive this benediction as you go. Your pastors will be around. If there's anything you need prayer for, anything you need to talk about, any questions you need to have. 2 Corinthians 13:4 says, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be